and welcome to Dove Biology Apes Lessons to Go. In this video, we'll be exploring aquatic biodiversity, its threats, and conservation. Most of our marine biodiversity will be found in three places: at coral reefs, near coastlines, and at the ocean bottom. Now, people have been catching fish from the oceans for thousands of years, but it was only recently, in the 1950s, that anyone started to really keep records of the numbers and types of fish they caught. In 2005, scientists gathered as much of this data as they could and used it to produce global species density maps of the locations of fish populations over time as a way to measure marine biodiversity. In the 1960s, we can see that there are many areas where we have great species density, off the coast of South America and off the eastern coast of Africa. Just 10 years later, the overall species density in those areas was greatly reduced. And that trend continues as we move forward in time. The reason for this decrease in biodiversity is similar to the reason why terrestrial biodiversity is decreasing: habitat destruction, invasive species, population growth of humans, pollution, climate change, and over-harvesting. Habitat loss is our first major issue to marine ecosystems. Over 90% of all of fish species will spawn in coral reefs, mangroves, and coastal wetlands. These habitats are under particularly intense pressure from human activities, disappearing at a rate 2 to 10 times higher than tropical forests. Sea bottom habitats are further destroyed by dredging and trawling operations. Over 51% of all freshwater species are at risk for extinction due to damming and excessive water withdrawal. Invasive species is another major problem for marine ecosystems. 84% of coastal waters are being colonized by invasive species, which are leading to extinction of native fish. Many, like these lamprey that are parasitizing this fish here, come as stowaways in ballast tanks of large cargo ships, which keep them stable. Population growth and pollution are two additional problems to marine ecosystems. Populations are growing and a lot of them move towards the coasts, causing further habitat degradation and pollution. Over 80% of all ocean pollution is actually coming from the land. A lot of that is in the form of nitrates and phosphates from agricultural processes. The addition of nitrates and phosphates causes an over-nutrification of the water, leading to algal blooms and eventually dead zones. Climate change is going to be a major issue to marine ecosystems. Climate change can lead to sea level rise as Arctic ice melts. This will destroy coral reef and coastal wetland systems. In fact, there are some studies that state that many Pacific Island nations could lose over half of their protective coastal mangrove forests by 2100. Finally, our last big threat to marine ecosystems is over-harvest. According to the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization, 75% of the world's commercial fisheries are being fished at or beyond their estimated sustainable yields. And so therefore, our fish stocks may actually be depleted by 2048. With an increasing world population, we've had an equally increasing demand on fish. For a while, we were able to keep up with the demand by increasing the size of our fishing fleets, introducing open ocean factory ships, utilizing transparent lines, huge drift nets, bottom trawlers, and electronic fish finders. Unfortunately, our total annual catch has actually leveled off, and our fish catch per capita is no longer increasing. In fact, many populations of formerly abundant, high trophic level species of fish like cod have actually collapsed. Fishermen are now being reduced to actually catching fish that were used to be considered bait fish or were food for larger fish. There are several different fishing techniques that we use when we do industrial fishing. The first type that we'll look at is a trawler. Trawlers are these large nets that go along the bottom, catching fish that are near the ocean floor, like shrimp, cod, flounder, and scallops. These large nets are actually large enough to swallow 12 jumbo jets. One of the big negatives of trawling is that as these nets kind of drag along the ocean bottom, they're destroying bottom habitats, and they also collect a lot of unintended species, which we call bycatch. Our next type of fishing technology is going to be our purse seine nets. These are used to catch surface dwellers like tuna, mackerel, anchovies, and herring. Oftentimes, these fishing fleets will actually use spotter planes to find out where the schools of fish are so they can appropriately place their nets to catch fish. Unfortunately, with older purse seine nets, a lot of times you were catching things like dolphins as bycatch. Another strategy is long lining. Long lining uses long fish lines of up to 80 miles long that are hung with baited hooks. These are used to catch open ocean or bottom fish like swordfish, tuna, cod, sharks, and halibut. One of the big issues with long lining is sometimes the fishermen will discard the long lines, they'll just cut them, and they'll be left floating open, and a lot of seabirds and things might actually get caught in these long lines and get wrapped up, and then they drowned. Lastly, but not leastly, we have drift nets. Drift nets are nets that are hung as deep as 50 feet below the surface, and they can extend up to 40 miles in length, and they're suspended from floats or buoys. These are designed to catch fish as they swim along, but unfortunately these also trap and kill marine mammals, turtles, birds, and other bycatch. So, with the world's oceans being depleted, is aquaculture the answer? Aquaculture can be traced back to ancient cultures. There's actually depictions of tilapia being fished out of tanks in Egypt as early as 2500 BC. The earliest known written record of aquaculture techniques is attributed to Fan Li of China, who in 475 BC described pond construction and the growth characteristics of common carp. Aquaculture is now the fastest growing form of production of food production in the world. Nearly one-third of the seafood consumed in the world is farm-raised. Aquaculture has the potential to relieve pressure on dwindling wild seafood populations and create sustainable food supplies. However, fish farms can also have negative impacts on the environment and wild fish populations. They could put excess pressure on wild fish stocks, as those could be used to create high-protein feed for pellets. In fact, some farmed fish require four times the input of biomass to produce those farmed fish. Aquaculture can amplify and transfer diseases and parasites to wild fish populations. Because the populations are grown in such high density, many of those density-dependent diseases are in higher incidence, and so they could be passed easily to the wild fish that would be nearby these fish farms. They can pollute water systems with excess nutrients, excess fish feed that wasn't consumed, and also fish waste can pollute the environment, as well as chemicals and antibiotics that are used to try to minimize the disease that these farm fish might receive, that those antibiotics could pollute the nearby waters. Finally, another big issue with aquaculture is that it could actually compromise the native gene pools. If the farm fish escape and native species interbreed, we are destroying our native genetic biodiversity. This would be especially problematic if we were farming genetically engineered varieties, like the sumo salmon. There are many solutions for managing fisheries so that we can have fish stocks into the future. One solution is to monitor and establish fishing limits. Fishery biologists have been working to provide accurate estimates of the maximum sustainable yield for target species for a while. maximum sustainable yield, if you remember, is the number of a species that could be removed from a stock of animals or plants without impacting the long-term stability of that population. Maximum sustainable yield is relatively easy to estimate, but it's not as reliable a measure as once thought, because of the variation and complexity of all the different factors that can affect fish stocks are way too great to effectively develop an accurate maximum sustainable yield for any given fishery population. In recent years, management objectives have begun to actually reflect not only the biological yield of fisheries, but have also included economic and social considerations as well. This is referred to as the optimum sustained yield. This concept incorporates both economic and social aspects of fishing. By combining the idea of maximum sustainable yield with evaluations of economic benefits to the area, in the creation of jobs and money being added to local economies, as well as the social benefits of maintaining a traditional way of life. One way the United States has furthered our efforts into monitoring and establishing fishing limits was the reauthorization of the Magnuson-Stevenson Act. On January 12, 2007, President Bush reauthorized the Magnuson-Stevenson Fishery Conservation and Management Act. This reauthorization mandates the use of annual catch limits and accountability measures to end overfishing. It also calls for an increased international cooperation towards the establishment of fishing limits. Another major way that we can help to sustain our fisheries is through the removal of subsidies. Many governments continue to give their fishing fleets large subsidies to allow them to fish longer, harder, and further away than would otherwise be possible. The removal of these subsidies will minimize the ability for fishing fleets to be able to access fish and could actually be a major thing to actually protect our world's oceans. Another big way that we can help to sustain fisheries is through restricting where fish farms can go. By minimizing the location of where we can establish aquaculture industries, you're going to protect not only coastal habitats, but also the fishing stocks that are present there. Finally, we can protect our fisheries from the impacts of invasive species by mandating that large ships that have ballast tanks filter or kill the invasive species that are present in that ballast before they are actually released into shallow waters. There are also a lot of ways to sustain overall aquatic biodiversity, not only our fisheries. One way to do that is through the establishment of laws. For example, the International Convention for the Regulation of Whaling is an international agreement signed in 1946 to provide for conservation of whale stocks and make possible the orderly development of the whaling industry. It actually governs the commercial, scientific, and aboriginal subsistence whaling practice for 59 member nations. Another major law would be the Marine Mammal Protection Act, which prohibits, with certain exceptions, the take of marine mammals in U.S. waters by U.S. citizens and the importation of marine mammals and marine mammal products. The establishment of bottom trawling restrictions so that we can protect fragile bottom habitats from degradation. And how we catch fish using nets can be modified so that we reduce our bycatch and capture of seabirds and sea turtles. In fact, since 1991, the U.S. has actually required the use of turtle exclusion devices, or TEDs, in all their shrimp trawlers. Another way that we can protect marine biodiversity is through the establishment of marine sanctuaries and reserves. In 2006, President Bush established the world's largest marine sanctuary in the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, including 195,000 square miles of coral reefs, underwater volcanoes, rare fish, and unique habitats. Despite the establishment of this large marine sanctuary, less than 1% of the world's oceans are actually protected. Another way that we can protect marine biodiversity is through protecting coastal habitats. And one way to do that is through establishing an integrated coastal management system. where we establish cooperative efforts on how to use coastal resources more sustainably by bringing together developers, conservationists, and fishermen. We can establish plans that will help to manage our coastal environments more effectively. Many difficulties in protecting marine biodiversity. A lot of the damage to marine ecosystems is not visible to people. A lot of folks still see the sea as an inexhaustible resource and able to absorb an infinite amount of waste. A lot of the world's oceans lies outside of the legal jurisdictions of any country, and it's very difficult to develop, monitor, and enforce international treaties, as evidenced by a lot of the controversy surrounding international whaling. Despite these difficulties, individuals can play an important role in helping sustain marine biodiversity through simply the choices we make and the types of seafood we consume. A few simple tips goes a long way. For example, we could eat lower on the food chain. Smaller fish tend to be more plentiful and better for our health because they contain less mercury. A lot of great small seafood choices would include oysters, mackerel, sardines, squids, and mussels. We could buy American products because American seafood, though not being perfect, the United States variety of fish is typically better than the imported counterpart because we have stricter fishing and farming standards than other parts of the world. We should buy wild fish. Given the current issue with environmental impact on fish farming, wild fish is almost always better than farm fish of the same variety. We should know how fish is caught. As we know that there are more sustainable ways to harvest fish, and if we choose fish that are harvested more sustainably, not using trawling or not using modern netting techniques, we're able to help sustain a lot of different biodiversities. And then finally, we can look for the label for sustainable seafood. The Marine Stewardship Council certifies seafood that's caught or raised in a sustainable or environmentally friendly manner. Items that meet its criteria are marked with an MSC-certified label like this one shown here. By making a few simple choices, we can go a long way to help support biodiversity and ensure that we will have fish well into the future.